Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege of coming before you tonight once again to study your word. We're praying, O Lord, that all that we hear and all that we study, your spirit will take these words and write them on the tables of our hearts in Jesus' name, that Christ will live within us the life of peace and the life of living for other people, that will put others above us and beyond us, preferable to us, in Jesus' name. Teach us your word today, and grant us the grace to be obedient to the word. In Jesus' name we pray. We continue with our study. We are already in the epistle of James. The Lord has helped us, and systematically we have studied now from chapter 1 to the end of chapter 3. We now begin chapter 4, and we're looking at the first 3 verses today. Please open your Bible to James chapter 4 as we read together from verses 1, 2, and 3. From whence come wars and fightings among you? Come they not hence, even of your lust that war in your members? Ye lust and have not, ye kill and desire to have, and cannot obtain. Ye fight and war, yet ye have not, because ye ask not. Ye ask and receive not, because ye ask amiss, that ye may consume it upon your lusts. Those are the verses we're looking at today. You will discover from the verses we have read, you will know that there is a problem. And you will know there is the poverty of these people that were calling upon the Lord. And then you see the reason why is because of their prayerlessness. The problem, you find that in verse 1. There are wars and conflicts and fightings among the people. And their spiritual poverty. You will see the use of the word not in verse 2. Ye lost and have not. Ye kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. Ye fight and war, yet ye have not, because ye ask not. You find that the verse is dominated by the negative. And then it tells us about the prayerlessness in verse 3. Ye ask and receive not, because ye ask amiss, that ye may consume it upon your lust. Now you'll find that the apostle here, he starts with a question. Actually, when he wants to bring the truth across, he puts a question before the hearers. He had done that in chapter 3, I hope you remember, when he was saying, does the fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? He followed with another question, can the fig tree, my brethren, bear olive trees, either a vine figs? So, can no fountain but yield salt water and fresh? Whenever he wanted to point out the contradiction in the lives of the people he was talking to, he will come with an obvious question that didn't require an answer. And here he comes in verse 1 and he says, I noticed something among you. I noticed discord and disunity, disagreement, wars, fightings, conflict, everything negative. From where does that come? You know why I was asking the question? Because of the end of verse of chapter 3. Look at chapter 3, verse 17. It says, but wisdom, which is from above, is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. You know what he's saying? If that verse 17 was fulfilled in the lives of the people, there'll be no war, there'll be no conflict, there'll be no fighting, there'll be no disagreement among them. And that's why I was asking the question. We're going to look at it. The passage we're studying today is under the title, Fearful Consequences of a Self-Dominated Life. James wants to point out something. It's either you are controlled by self or you are controlled by the Spirit of God. If you are controlled by the Spirit of God, there's going to be peace, there's going to be joy, there's going to be patience and long-suffering, the fruit of the Spirit. If you, on the other hand, if you are dominated by self, we're going to find what he describes in verse 1. Each verse takes a point. There are 3 verses. Verse 1, point 1, conflict among unrighteous people. And then in verse 2, you have point 2, the consequence of unbelief and prayerlessness. And then verse 3 gives us point number 3, the causes of unanswered prayer. Let's go to number 1, conflict among righteous people. In verse 1, I read again. It says, from whence come wars and fightings among you? Come they not hence, even of your lust, that is selfish desire, consuming desire, a kind of unrighteous passion, your lust that war in your members? Here he tells us very clearly that if we find conflict, if we find contradictions among us, it is not coming from a Christian principle. It is not coming from the presence and the preeminence and the prominence of Christ reigning within. You know why? Because Isaiah tells us far back, before 700 years before he was born, he called Jesus Christ the Prince of Peace. You know what? When Jesus Christ was born, those angels sang, they said, there is peace on earth, goodwill among men. And then you understand, it says the fruit of the Spirit is love and joy and peace. And then when the peace of God is there, when the Spirit of God is there, there will be peace and there will be liberty, there will be fellowship, communion among the people of God. He said, if that is so, and if it is true that the wisdom that comes from above will bring purity, will bring peace, and will bring a gentleness and kindness, will bring forgiveness and love, will bring mercy and good fruits, and there will be no partiality, there will be no hypocrisy, from whence then, my brethren, come wars and fightings among you? Then the answer, very quickly, you go back to chapter 3, verse 14. He finds an answer for us in chapter 3, verse 14. But if ye have bitter envy and strife in your heart, glory not, lie not against the truth. This wisdom, that is that kind of wisdom producing strife, producing envy and bitterness and hatred, this kind of wisdom descended not from above. It is earthly, it is sensual, it is devilish. In verse 16, for where envy and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. Actually, if we will allow Christ in us and the teaching of Christ in us, you know, there will be no strife at all, there will be no conflict at all, there will be no war, and there will be no fighting at all. Whether it's in a small family, or in a little house fellowship, or it's in a zone, or in our district and local church, or in the central church, in the church in general, there will be no conflict when we follow the teachings of Christ. What's the teaching of Christ? In Matthew chapter 5, Matthew chapter 5, reading from verse 39, but I say unto you, that ye receive not evil. It's not evil to me, I'll pay him back. It's not that to me, I'll throw it at him as well. He said, no, you are for peace. So I, child of God, Christ, the wisdom of God, is dwelling within you. You cannot resist and retaliate with evil. It says, but whosoever shall smite thee on the right cheek, it says, turn to him the other also. When he said, whosoever that brings in everybody, you know, when somebody that is much authoritative and greater and higher than you, when he does something you don't like, you have a way of keeping quiet. It is when somebody who is junior to you, when he does something, your wife, for example, when he does something, it's then you say, how can that happen? And then strife will begin. If you did what Jesus said, that whosoever will slap you on the one cheek, turn the other also, there will be no quarreling, there will be no conflict, there will be no fighting, there will be no war at all. In Genesis chapter 13, Abraham demonstrated to us very clearly that when we are controlled by the Spirit of God and Christ is reigning within us and the principle and the teaching of Christ is reigning within us and that wisdom from above is within us, there will be no strife at all. Genesis 13 verse 8, and Abraham said unto the Lord, let there be no strife, I pray thee, between me and thee, between my herdsmen and thy herdmen, for we are brethren. If we remember that every time we have been born again, Things have changed. All things have passed away. All things have become new. There will be no fighting. There will be no quarreling in our midst at all. But you know the life we're living now. And you know the condition of the kingdom of God. At this time, Jesus told us, he told us a parable. He said the kingdom of God is like wheat that is sown in a field. And then in the night, the enemy came and he sowed tares inside. Because of the presence of the tares among the wheat. That's why you find that kind of problem today. It was like that among the children of Israel. Numbers chapter 11. Numbers chapter 11, reading from verse 4. It says, and the mixed multitude that was among them fell at lusting. And then it says, and the children of Israel also wept again and said, who shall give us bread to eat? You find among the children of Israel, they were singing when they came out of Egypt. They were rejoicing when they passed through the Red Sea. But now, the mixed multitude, the people that didn't have a bona fide experience of salvation, the people that didn't have the real knowledge and the real grace of God within them, they fell at lusting. And then problems began. And from then on, you find problems upon problems, conflict and fighting and warring among them. In Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, you understand here that it is when our hearts are not circumcised. It's when we're not fully and truly converted. It is when we have not allowed Christ to be reigning fully within us. We contribute to war and to fighting and to conflict and to disagreement and discord. In Romans chapter 8, reading from verse 7, because the carnal mind is enmity against God. For it is not subject, not submissive to the law of God. Neither indeed can be. That verse is full and pregnant with meaning. It says the carnal mind, that's the corrupt mind, that's the unconverted mind, that's the one that doesn't know Christ, that's the one that doesn't have the Prince of Peace living within him, is enmity against God. And it's enmity against everything that God stands for. It's in enmity against the truth of God. And then it says, it is not subject to the law of God. It is not submissive to the word of God. He may hear, he will not be able to obey. Then it says, neither indeed can be. Even if he wanted to, he will not be able to. But you know, that's how we were before ourselves in Titus chapter 3. Titus chapter 3, reading from verse 3, it says, for we ourselves also were sometimes foolish. Stop there for a moment and look at that word, don't miss it. Were. In the past, if we are born again, we are not like that anymore. If we are children of God, we are not like that anymore. If the grace of God has appeared unto us, teaching us to deny ungodliness and worldly lusts, to live soberly, righteously, godly in this present world, we are not like that anymore. Before we were born again, we were sometimes foolish and disobedient and deceived, serving diverse laws and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another. You see that? That's how strife comes. That's how conflict comes. That's why there is fighting among some people. That's why there's no peace between husband and wife, and between two sisters living together, between two so-called brothers living together. In verse 4, but after that the kindness and the love of God as Savior toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. That's the dividing line. That's the thing that makes the change. That is the thing that takes the conflict away and takes the war away and takes the fighting away, the salvation of the Lord. It comes with peace in our heart. You love peace. You desire peace. You'll pursue peace. You want to be at peace with all men. As long as it rests in your power, you'll want to be at peace. He saved us by the washing of regeneration. There is regeneration, therefore there is renewal, there is restoration, and therefore there is something within you that wants to live the life of Christ, and the renewing of the Holy Spirit, the renewing of the Holy Ghost. You see, if we're real children of God, things will change, and the fighting will not be there again, and the warning will not be there again. In fact, we're told in 1 Peter chapter 1, 1 Peter chapter 1, reading from verse 14, it says, as obedient children, children in the family of God, as obedient children washed in the blood of the Lamb, as obedient children, you are now following Jesus Christ, who is the captain of our salvation, not fashioning yourselves according to the former laws in your ignorance. When you were ignorant of grace and devoid of grace, without God, without Christ, without grace in the world, there was fighting. But now, as children of God, not fashioning yourself as it was in those days. In those days, if you didn't see a fight, you'll say, what happened today? You'll be looking for one. You'll want to create one. You want to stir up one if there wasn't a fight. But it says now, you are different. You are now a child of God. It must not be like that again. It tells us in that same 1 Peter chapter 2 and in verse 11, dearly beloved, I beseech you, as strangers and pilgrims. It says we are strangers here. Strangers don't fight for anything. We don't merit anything. It says we are pilgrims here. We are on the move. And we are moving somewhere. And our eyes and our focus is on the eternal home. Because we are strangers, because we are pilgrims, it says abstain from fleshly lusts, from those consuming desires, from those passions of the flesh, which war against the soul. It tells us in chapter 4, 1 Peter chapter 4, reading there from verse 2, that he no longer shall live the rest of his time in the flesh to the lusts of men, but to the will of God. And what's the will of God? That will be at peace with one another. What's the will of God? There'll be no fighting, there'll be no conflict or discord or disunity among you. What's the will of God? That they all may be one as we are one, the Father and the Son, and they one in us. That's the will of God. It says in verse 3, for the time past of our life may suffice us to have wrought the will of the Gentiles. When we walked, that's past tense, when we walked before we were born again, when we walked in lasciviousness and lust and excess of wine and revelings and banquetings and abominable idolatries. It's telling us something. It's telling us that things have changed now. If we belong to the Lord, if we are born again, if we are children of God, if we are the congregation we ought to be, there should be no warring, there should be no fighting, there should be no conflict among us. Check up husband and wife, check up brothers, sisters living together. If we are always quarreling and we never see eye to eye, it's that we are not living according to the word of God. Maybe you say, I know I'm saved. I know I'm sanctified. The problem was with the other fellow. That's why there is a fight. We used to tell our children in the school, when I was teaching in the school, it takes two to fight. If you will not reply, if you turn the other cheek, if you prefer him before yourself, if you hand over everything to the Lord, if you allow God to take vengeance and you will not defend yourself, there will be no fighting at all. Let the grace of God become more abundant in our lives so that there will be no fighting again. There will be no warring again. There will be no conflict again. If there is conflict, we are dominated by self. When the Spirit of God is dominating, controlling us, there will be no conflict at all. Let's come back to James chapter 4. James chapter 4, in verse 2. Now, ye lust and have not, ye kill and desire to have and cannot obtain, ye fight and war, and yet ye have not because ye have not. Do you understand this verse here? It is going from bad to worse. It tells us you lust, you desire, you want to have, you passionately pursue. And then it comes to you kill. That kill there is used figuratively. You oppress, you knock the other one, you push the other one, you want to take advantage of the other one. Then it says you desire. You see how it's going on? And then it says you fight. And then it's internal. And it is just from one to one. Eventually it escalates to warring. And then it says you war. And then it now tells us, do they have? Just because they lost, just before they are willing to oppress, just before they desire passionately, and just because they fight and they war, do they get what they want? No. Look at that verse, and have not. Look at that verse, and cannot obtain. Look at that verse, yet ye have not. Look at it again, because ye ask not. You see the life of a person that is dominated by self is full of negatives. He cannot have, he will not have, the Lord will not give it to him, he cannot obtain. It's the consequence of unbelief and prayerlessness. Unbelief is a terrible sin, and unbelief is a sin that causes a lot of unrest and a lot of restlessness in the life of many so-called churchgoers. And the Lord is telling us we have to be very careful that that thing that is called unbelief does not appear, does not take root within our lives. Look at Hebrews chapter 3. Hebrews chapter 3 from verse 12. Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. There are people that are quick to tell us, once you are saved, you are forever saved. Once you are with the Lord, you are with the living God, you are forever with the living God. But here it says, take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you believers, an evil heart of unbelief in departing. They were with the Lord before. If you have not been in a house, you cannot depart from that house. If you have not been in a town, you will not depart from that town to go to another place. They were with the living God before, but now in departing from the living God. But exhort one another daily, while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. If somebody goes to sin and the Spirit of God warns him and he sins and he sins and he sins over and over again, eventually the conscience will be hardened. Lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. If you take note in the place we have read in James chapter 4, in verse 2 there, you will see that it says, you lust, you desire, you want to have, but you kill, you are seeking the wrong way, and you cannot obtain, you fight, and you war, you are in disagreement with everybody, you knock everybody, push everybody away, and yet with all that, you cannot have. You know the problem? The problem is a problem of unbelief. There are many people, they're greedy for money, they're greedy for power and for position. Maybe in the church, maybe in society, maybe in their place of work. They want prestige, they want recognition, worldly possession at all costs. There are some people, they want to get a woman, they want to get that woman now. They want to get married, they want the husband now. And they want whatever it is, they want it now. But there's unbelief, and there's prayerlessness, and they will not seek the face of the Lord. You know, there have been people like that in the Old Testament as well as in the New Testament. Did they have what they were lusting after? Did they have what they were desiring? Did they have what they wanted to kill and destroy other people to have? No, they couldn't have. Look at 2 Samuel chapter 15. 2 Samuel chapter 15, reading from verse 10. But Absalom sent spies throughout all the tribes of Israel, saying, as soon as ye hear the sound of the trumpet, then ye shall say, Absalom reigneth in Hebron. You know what he wanted? He wanted a throne. His father was still on the throne. He didn't care. The desire to sit on that throne and to be called the king was so much in him. He didn't care for the life of his own father. Did he have it? No, he couldn't have it. That's not how to have it. People cannot have things that way. There are people that are looking for healing. They're looking for deliverance. They're looking for something at all costs. And it doesn't matter. Tell them there is a miracle at the bar beach. Tell them there is a miracle in the forest. Tell them the miracle is somewhere. It doesn't matter whether the people, they are obeying the Bible or not, whether they are serving God in spirit and in truth. And it says, I want it at all costs. They don't preach holiness there. I don't care for that. They don't believe restitution. I don't care for that. They are not following the principle of love, the life of Christ. I don't care for that. I want what I want. Do they get it? Look at 2 Kings. In 2 Kings chapter 1, 2 Kings chapter 1, reading from verse 2. And Ahaziah fell down through a lattice in his upper chamber that was in Samaria and was sick. And he sent messengers and said unto them, go, inquire of Beelzebub, the god, the idol of Ekron, whether I shall receive whether I shall recover of this disease. Here you find somebody who was sick. It's legitimate to get healed. It's legitimate to want healing. It's legitimate to want children if you are barren. It's legitimate to have deliverance if there is any oppression, any attack. But you seek from God. You seek from the living God. You don't push God aside and make having children, having healing, having deliverance more important than God, more important than the word of God. You see this Ahaziah. He was sent to the Ekrons. He was sent to Beelzebub. He wanted to know, will I get well? In verse 3, but the angel of the Lord said to Elijah the Tishbite, arise, go up to meet the messengers of the king of Samaria, and say unto them, is it not because there is not a God in Israel that ye go to inquire of Beelzebub, the God of Ekron? Now therefore, thus saith the Lord, that thou shalt not come down from that bed on which thou art gone up, but shall surely die. You see that? The thing he wanted, he didn't get it. Look at verse 17. So he died according to the word of the Lord which Elijah had spoken. He wanted it, but he didn't get it. Because he wasn't following after God. He didn't do what the Lord wanted him to do. He could have repented at that time. He could have said, I'm sorry, I will not seek the God of Ekron anymore. But he persisted. That's the unbelief. That's the prayerlessness. That's seeking after man, wanting to have man as their arm, as their succor, as their support. Jeremiah tells us in Jeremiah chapter 17. Jeremiah chapter 17 in verse 5, Jeremiah 17:5, thus says the Lord, cursed be the man that trusteth in man and maketh flesh his arm, whose heart departeth from the Lord. When you want something so passionately, so seriously, you forget God, you forget the church, you forget here we can pray, and you forget we have the name of Jesus, you forget the promises of the Lord, you forget that we're not to seek after the God of the Ekrons, and you want that deliverance, healing, miracle, children, whatever. You want it at all costs. Cursed be the one that trusteth in man and maketh flesh his arm, whose heart departed from the Lord. That's the secret. People tell us, oh yes, even though I've left the church, even though I left sanctification, even though I left sound doctrine, even though I left the people of God, I'm still with the Lord. I'm still born again. Even though I depend on those people, even though I'm doing what they are saying now, even though I'm practicing things not according to the word of God, I am still in the faith. Whose heart departed from the Lord. I pray God will help us that we will not depart from the Lord. Whatever it is we want, it is in the Lord. We're going to get it in the Lord in Jesus' name. You know, a true believer, he will not fight. A true believer, he'll not quarrel with anybody. A true believer will learn to pray and will go to God in prayer and say, God, here is my petition. And then after he has done all, he'll be waiting patiently for the Lord to fulfill the promise that he has given unto him. And he will say, Lord, thy will be done, not my will. But the people in James chapter 4 that we're studying about today, they were not like that. They were very, very different. And I pray that your life will not be like this in Jesus' name. Let's come back to chapter 4. We're coming to point number 3. Chapter 4, looking at point number 3, the causes of unanswered prayer. It says now in verse 3, ye ask, now they even prayed, and received not. Isn't that something? In verse 2, they didn't ask. In verse 2, they didn't pray. In verse 2, they didn't call upon the Lord, and so they could not have. In verse 2, they were going it the human way. They wanted it in their own way, by fighting their way through, by pushing other people down, by contending for it at all costs, by getting rid of others so they can replace them. But these other ones, in verse 3 now, they even began to pray. But it says, ye ask and receive not, because ye ask amiss, that ye may consume it upon your laws. Here we learn something. There are people that pray, and yet their prayers are not answered. James makes it very clear to us. He clears the confusion. He says, answers do not come to our prayers just because we pray, just because we ask, just because we open our mouth and we say something and we make some requests. You know, the answer to come will depend on who you are, will depend on how you are, how you act, your behavior, your character, your life, what you are being and what you are today. All those things are a part of the answers to prayer. The Bible tells us very clearly, our motives matter, our attitudes matter, our behavior matters, and our character matters a lot. They either will help us to have our prayers answered, or they will hinder us from having our prayers answered. If there is hypocrisy in our praying, if there is hatred, if there is selfishness, if there is pride, if there is the love of the world, if we're practicing secret sin somehow, somewhere, all those things will hinder our prayer. Look at what the Bible says. Why some people ask and they are not given? Why some people ask and they do not receive what they are asking? In Job chapter 27. Job chapter 27, reading from verse 8. Job 27 verse 8. Here it says, for what is the hope of the hypocrite? Though he has gained, when God taketh away his soul, will God hear his cry? When trouble cometh upon him, will he delight himself in the Almighty? Will he always call upon God? Here we find something here. It's telling us that hypocrisy will hinder our prayers from being answered. We're one thing in the church, we're another thing at home. We appear like angels when we're in the district, but we appear like devils when we're in our offices. If we're like the chameleon, that we're here and there, and our lives are not the way they ought to be, hypocrisy will hinder our prayers from being answered. In Job chapter 35, Job chapter 35, reading there from verse 12. In verse 12, there they cry, but not give us answer, because of the pride of evil men. Surely God will not hear vanity, neither will the Almighty regard it. Here we find pride is another thing. When you exalt yourself above teaching, when you exalt yourself above the instruction of the Word of God, when you exalt yourself above correction, and the pride of your heart zooms so high that it blinds you, it deafens you, and you will not hear anything at all, pride hinders our prayer. In Psalm 66, Psalm 66, reading from verse 18. If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. If you regard that iniquity and that sin in your heart, and you cherish that sin, and you are petting yourself on that sin, and you are committing that sin secretly, your conscience tells you it's not right, and the Word of God tells you it's not right, but you enjoy the sin. You cherish the sin. You embrace the sin. You are holding on to the sin. You refuse to repent, and you refuse to give it up. The Lord will not answer the prayer of such an individual like that in Proverbs chapter 1. Proverbs chapter 1, reading from verse 28. Then shall they call upon me, and I will not answer. They shall seek me early, but they shall not find me. For they hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and to depart from iniquity, that is understanding. When they do not fear the Lord, when they do not know the Lord, that the Lord sees all their actions and the Lord knows everything, and they do not fear to do evil, even in the presence of God, it says because they hated knowledge. And because they did not choose the fear of the Lord, then it says in verse 30, they would none of my counsel. I counseled them, I commanded them, they would none of it, they despise all my reproof. Therefore, shall they eat the fruit of their own way, and be filled with their own devices, and the turning away of the simple shall slay them, and the prosperity of fools shall destroy them. But whoso hearkeneth unto me shall dwell safely and shall be quiet from the fear of evil. You see what the Lord is saying here? If we remain in sin and we do not regard the word of the Lord and we do not take holiness, righteousness, purity of heart seriously, then it hinders our prayer. In Proverbs chapter 28, Proverbs chapter 28, verse 29, he that turneth away his ear from hearing the law, even his prayer. You see that? They turn their ears away from hearing the word of God. They say, I don't want commandments. I don't want all those rules and regulations, all those principles of living, the character, all that I don't want. Tell me about faith. Tell me about fasting. Tell me about how to get a miracle. Tell me about signs and wonders. You know what? He that turneth away his ears from hearing the law, even his prayer, of course, his life, his personality, his abomination to the Lord, his motive, abomination to the Lord, his attitude, abomination to the Lord. And come to it now, even his prayer shall be abomination unto the Lord. That's the problem. When people abandon sound doctrine, when people abandon the word of God, and they will none of the word of God, they say, no, doctrine is not the issue now. I say, I'm looking for children, you are talking about a doctrine. I say, I'm looking for prosperity, I'm looking for work, and you are talking about doctrine. I don't want doctrine now. All I want is miracle. They don't get miracle that way. In Micah chapter 3, we're looking at the causes of unanswered prayer. And you examine your life, and if you see all these things there, hypocrisy, or you find pride, or you find secret sin, or you find that you are rebellious and disobedient to the word of God, or you find that you don't cherish, you do not embrace, you will not meditate upon the word of God, you push the word of God aside, no wonder there is hindrance to the answer to your prayer. In Micah chapter 3, reading from verse 4. Then shall they cry unto the Lord, but he will not hear them. He will even hide his face from them at that time, as they have behaved themselves ill in their doings. You know, they say that character doesn't matter. If you can fast 7, 14, 21 days, the Lord must see that, and the Lord must answer, hear what the Lord is saying. He will hide his face. He will not answer because they behaved themselves ill in their doings. That means they didn't behave right. They didn't act well. Because of that, he will not hear. Zechariah tells us the same thing. You see how the whole Bible is united on this? That if we want answer to our prayer, if we want the Lord to answer our prayers, that we have to give ourselves fully to the Lord and be obedient to the word of the Lord. Obedience, righteousness, holiness, it counts very much in answers to prayer. In Zechariah chapter 7, reading from verse 12. Yea, they made their hearts as an adamant stone. That means they were rebellious. It means they were stubborn. It means they were hardened. It means their conscience was dead. They made their hearts like an adamant stone, lest they should hear the law. And it says, the word which the Lord opposed as sent. And then it says, in his spirit, by the former prophets, therefore came a great wrath from the Lord of hosts. Therefore, in verse 13, it has come to pass that as he cried, and they would not hear, so they cried, and I will not hear, says the Lord of hosts. Very clearly in the word of God, our character matters. Seeking what you desire by strife, or without any regard to the rights of other people, and yet praying fervently, expecting from the Lord, results in disappointment. There are people that pray for success in their worldly engagements, and though those engagements are all based on covetousness and selfish greed, if such people, if they do not receive what they have set their hearts upon, it is not because God cannot answer prayer, it is because they themselves are living in an improper, unrighteous manner. They have unrighteous motive. Don't you understand? A holy God cannot, will not grant anything that you want for your self-indulgence, that you want for your carnal gratification. prayer offered that is only to satisfy your lust, is only to indulge self, is only to oppress other people, or is to help you to sin more and more and to gratify the desires and the pleasures of the flesh and to only increase vanity in your life, that cannot be answered. What's the Lord telling us? What's he calling us to? We find that in Isaiah chapter 1. Isaiah chapter 1. Reading from verse 16. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 16. Wash you, make you clean, put away the evil of your doings from before mine eyes. Cease to do evil, learn to do well. Seek justice, seek judgment, and relieve the oppressed, and judge the fatherless, and plead for the widows. It's telling us that hope is not lost yet. He still can answer our prayers. All the fighting can stop. All the quarreling can stop. All the conflict can come to an end. We can enjoy the peace of God. And we can enjoy answers to our prayers. But then he tells us, you have something to do. You're washed in the blood of the Lamb. You will repent from every form of evil. And then you will come before the Lord. And you will ask for the grace to do what is right. And you will learn to do well. Holiness, righteousness, obedience will become important to you. Will become a priority in your life. You want to seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness in preparation that he might add all other things unto you. Do you realize in verse 17, self is out of the way? Do you realize in verse 17, self is no more on the throne? You are thinking of other people. You love other people. You are desiring the blessing of other people. And you prefer other people above yourself. And then it says, after you are ready for that, then it says in verse 18, come now and let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, he's willing to forgive. He's willing to take your sins away. If you'll come in the fountain flowing from Emmanuel's side, he'll wash all the sins away. He says, they shall be as white as snow. He says, though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Then he puts a condition in verse 19. If ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land. If we continue fighting and we continue quarreling and we continue, I must have my way, I want it at all costs, it must be mine, we don't get blessing that way. If we come tonight and say, Lord, I see I'm wrong. Self has been on the throne. I've been fighting for myself. I've been defending myself. I've forgotten the words of Jesus Christ. If they slap you on the one cheek, turn the other to them. Oh Lord, I am sorry. I want Christ to come and reign in my heart. I want peace in my heart today. I'll not fight for anything anymore. If I don't have it, I don't have it. If I'm going to get it, only God must give me. I will not seek for it on the mountain. I'll not seek for it in the valley. I want it from the Lord alone. Lord, I hand up and I surrender everything, thy will be done. Then days of blessing will start in your life. Why don't you come to the Lord today? Rise up on your feet and tell the Lord, I repent. And tell the Lord, all those things I've been doing and the ways I've been going, the quarreling and the fighting and the conflict and the discord in the district, there is no peace anymore. In the zone, there is no peace anymore. In the earth fellowship, there is no peace anymore. It is fighting. It is debate. It is quarreling. It is discord. All that we're going to bury, we want the peace of the Lord. We want unity. We want fellowship. We want the love of the Lord. And then when you allow Christ to reign without a rival in your life and in your heart, then all those things you are seeking for, the Lord has promised he'll give them unto you. Repent before the Lord and put yourself, your heart, in the right way before the Lord. And all the blessings of the Lord will be yours from tonight.